Hi, everybody. This is David, your instructor for Inclusion of Students with Special Needs Education 605, Viterbo University. This is Module 6, Fireside Chat for April 10th through April 16th, 2017. So welcome to what isn't exactly the warmest start to April that I remember, but it looks like we've got some warm days ahead of us. I'm thinking of 3 weeks ago being in Orlando and mid-80s and blue skies and sun and thinking, yes, I miss that. But those days will be back here in Wisconsin before too long. So we are focused on, honestly, probably the most exciting module for me, which is Universal Design for Learning. It just is my passion. And what I love about UDL is UDL is incorporates, I would say, differentiated instruction, you know, of how to deliver instruction, but also then how to receive learning from students. And it's that two-way street. That's what UDL is. So it's always exciting for me. I love Universal Design for Learning. So as we look at some of the resources for this week, I do have the course module up. And before I move into talking about the module, one is I'm going back and I'm double checking on your checklist points that have been accrued. If there is some reason that some of the videos, you know, that you've watched in class, you know, have clicked on are not showing up as credited, in that checklist, I'm making some adjustments, to make sure that you earn credit for those. I'm not exactly sure why some of that might be happening. But I have gone in as of last night and kind of updated, went through everything. Moodle has a new gradebook since Christmas, which you're aware of. I've talked about that, but there's some, it's definitely, I like it over the previous one, but there's differences. And what happens is, you know, the way you design things are if you bring forward some previous gradebook, modules that you had, it's not a perfect fit. So you have to go in and kind of tweak things. So I want to make sure that if you do notice anything out of the ordinary, let me know. But as far as like scores on assignments and all of that, you know, I'm entering those in. Again, if you do not see a score in a box, if there's just a dash, that means I haven't entered anything in. So if there's like a zero in a box, yeah, that's a reason to get a hold of me. But, and if there's a dash, then that box or that column, so let's say that assignment, that discussion thread or whatever, that then is not included in the calculation of your grade. So it's once I go in and actually put a score in there, then it gets brought into the calculation. So again, I looked, everyone is doing really well in the class. So please keep it up. And you've been very active posters. I appreciate that. Thanks again. So this week with UDL, we talk about UDL resource page. We look at that right away. Talks about access, assessment, and engagement. You can click on each of those and get more information, but access, assessment, and engagement. So it's really exciting for me because this is one of those things that you don't have to complicate it. You know, this is what it is, okay? Access, assessment, and engagement. And there's actually a poster. I'll get down to it, Sarah. Maybe it wasn't you, Sarah. Sorry about that. But somebody had included a UDL doc that went to a poster link. Trina, that was you. Awesome. You know, the fact that you can really kind of get UDL down to like an 8x11 sheet of paper of like, here's what UDL is and the tenets of UDL. So the DPI has done a super job putting together UDL pages. And keeping those updated. And one of those things that's like, we don't often think of the resources that the DPI has available, one, right on their website. And so what do? Is you know, we look through Amazon or we look through for articles and things like that and search the net, and it's like, whoa, the DPI has really done a lot of work, a lot of heavy lifting in putting together some very, very nice UDL resources. So go to that DPI link and explore what the DPI has available for UDL. Really has, they've done a nice job with that. The National UDL YouTube channel. I love that. One of the things, when you do bring up the channel, it seems to kind of bring up the same videos within the first like 5 or 10 videos. You got to dig a little bit deeper to maybe find a little more of the original stuff. I think it kind of sorts it out by popularity and not by like newness. So you might have something that's really cool and new, but then it doesn't, you have to kind of dig through to find it in the UDL YouTube channel. So when you use that channel, you know, make sure you're not just pulling off the first, second, third video that you see and say, here's three videos I found. Spend some time, you know, hunt through that. There are, you know, tons and tons of videos, and it does, it's not sorted. I think, you know, here's the best examples first. Not that there are best examples and good examples and fair examples and poor examples, but I think it's done on rankings and views and things like that. So you want to dig in a little bit deeper. And some of you have done that. You've pulled out some of the videos that that are a little bit newer, and then also more, you know, kind of more exclusive in areas that they might address. So something that's very helpful when you write about that is to put a statement in your response, like, at the 8-minute, 12-second mark of the video, I noticed the instructor doing this. You know, the teacher was doing this. And the student, Billy, and the other student, you know, Emily, stopped. And they then were asked to briefly explain to each other, you know, what they were doing on their projects or something, whatever it was. But if you give that timestamp, it helps a lot. I don't always do that either. I've learned more to do that in different work that I do with videos. But to timestamp things out, it saves a lot of time, even though the videos aren't very long, but to say at this point in the video, like, I saw this and I think this really is relevant to our discussion because of this point. Or if there's something you say, I saw this and I'm not sure that I would do that or that aligns with UDL. So I have some questions about that. Again, you know, it's not to agree with everything that's put out there. You know, some of this can be challenged or questioned, saying, I don't quite understand why that would have been pointed out as an example of UDL. It just kind of seemed like differentiated instruction. So anyway, I also posted an article from American or the Association of School Business Officers, the February 2017 edition. The irony there is that I had the feature article published in that magazine, and it was about, it was called Lessons of Lower Manhattan, basically like a 4-page condensed version of my book, and they did some great work with graphics that they pulled into that. So I had the feature article in the National Magazine, and I'm paging through, and then all of a sudden I'm like, whoa, like, here's an article about co-op services between districts to help improve special education you know, programs and services. And then thinking, boy, that fits really well into inclusion. And, you know, also it as we talk about, you know, universal design for learning, I think it gives you more ideas if you're able to also kind of work within your co-op to see what other teachers are doing in ways that they might be accessing assessment engagement. Just that if you have that co-op, you can see how that's happening outside of your own district too. And there's other pluses in the way to kind of share, you know, resources, things like that. So it could fit into some different modules, but I think here for universal design for learning, we get centric. I mean, we look at what we do or what might happen in the classrooms right around us or at our grade level, but we don't look beyond into other schools of what's happening. And if you have a co-op that you work with, that can really come to light. Back when I first, not when I first started, I was a special education director, but kind of middle of my career, I was part of the founding members of the Sauk County Directors of Pupil Services, you know, which has since dissolved. But we did create where we had Baraboo, Reedsburg, Spring Green, Lodi, and Sauk Prairie all together in sharing services in kind of this co-op model. And we shared professional development. So we would bring in, you know, presenters on certain things, and then, you know, each of the districts could come together and be there. But we also had teachers visit into the other districts, and then we did share some actual resource materials that we had. But it was a phenomenal experience for our teachers within that consortium to say, I didn't know that Sauk Prairie had, you know, did things this way at this level in Sauk. You know, they may come and visit and say, wow, you know, you found, I looked in this classroom and it was amazing how students were doing this way to demonstrate learning. And so I'm going to come back and talk about that in my school. So it was this thing then, yeah, where you had just this, even, and what was also special about it is, we shared students. You know, students would move, and usually students, if they move, they might move from Baraboo to Reedsburg, Reedsburg to Sauk. So, I mean, we also had this commonality of, you know, the types of students that we served. So, anyway, I want to talk about the two, kind of the two assignments we have due. One is due on the 13th, Thursday the 13th. And again, that's with the UDL videos. Again, don't go, please. I mean, if you want to take the first video that shows up and you go through it and you have reasons why, that's fine. But take some time to explore the different videos which are on YouTube. There's a lot of them that have to do with universal design for learning. And then if you could timestamp, you know, saying at the 2 minute and 55 mark or the 7 minute and 8 second mark, this is what I saw. And if you already posted and you didn't do that, that's okay. I'm just saying it's easier for the reader then to go into the video and to kind of find the exact point you were making, or when it comes up, they're like, oh, here it is. Now I know what you're talking exactly about. So helpful. On Saturday, the 15th of April, the demonstrating knowledge assignment. So demonstrating your knowledge of UDL. This is cool. You can do virtually anything you want as long as it meets, you know, the assignment specifications of demonstrating understanding of UDL, meaning you could create your own YouTube video about UDL. I mean, if you do, like, make it 5, 6 minutes long. You could create a poster, you could create a Prezi, a PowerPoint, a blog, or make a blog post. Or someone made a Jeopardy game once. There are so many ways you can demonstrate your learning, a podcast, whatever you want to do, okay? So the sky is the limit. And if you do feel like, you know, you don't want to go out to quite to the level of like making your own YouTube video. And it could be just, it doesn't have to mean like you are taking a camera and videotaping kids. It can be that you're just talking about your thoughts about UDL, and maybe you bring out some things and show like, here's UDL that I used I'm going to use in this one lesson, or, you know, a 5 minute interview with somebody else that you do with your camera phone and upload it, you know, or something like that. Whatever you want to do. You know, with that regard, but so people, it's been the gamut of what people do. And if you want to stay more traditional to like a Prezi or a PowerPoint or even like a poster, and someone made, a poster that they did on poster board actually, and then posted, you know, some pictures from magazines and some snapshots and things in that were specific to that person's classroom of what UDL is. And then they showed that up on the wall, took a picture of it in their classroom and how then they had used that to explain to students what UDL was, but then also how the teacher had it there as a reminder of, you know, that to demonstrate learning in a UDL manner and then also to receive learning in a UDL manner. So it was really cool. It was really cool stuff. So you can take that assignment as far as you want to take it. I'm going to try something here, which hopefully doesn't go horribly wrong. I'll just keep that up for the moment. Okay. Yes. Anyway, we are into shout outs. All right. I do have a stereo feature on this mic, but I do have it not set to that mode right now. So, Keely, you shared that you had not heard about UDL before this week. I smiled when I read that because I had not heard about UDL until probably about 5 years ago. And I've been instructing this course for 10 or more years. I honestly had just believed UDL was differentiated instruction. And again, differentiated instruction is, you know, a teacher providing information in visual, in audio, giving student, you know, presenting information in you know, multiple choice format, in short passage, and then, you know, narrative response format, things like that. But, you know, it's from the teacher side. And that's, so I'm thinking UDL is just really differentiated instruction. Remember at the start of this class, we talked about the terms of inclusion and mainstreaming and how those kind of get, you know, confabulated. People think it's the same thing. I kind of thought that too. So I'm where you were. But UDL is exciting because it's a representation, providing multiple means of representation, providing multiple means of action and expression. And then that third part, providing multiple means of engagement. Again, that's from the teacher to the student, but then it's from the student back to the teacher. And that's the part that I think that UDL comes in, is that focusing really on that student demonstration. So, I mean, it's really cool. I was talking with a teacher who had used a version of the Oregon Trail game, which came out in 1977. I did a very interesting interview for my Safety Doc podcast a few weeks ago with Sean Dickers, who is a game designer and also a professor. Works with multiplayer games, but we were talking somewhat about the Oregon Trail, but this discussion is different than what I covered in that podcast. But this student had used the Oregon Trail as a way to talk about how they played the game and then how they had to make decisions along the way. So, you know, it was demonstrating an understanding of units that kind of went with that of you know, like, the settling of the West and so forth, but, you know, the making the determination on provisions and things like that, and using this game of having to make these choices and having to and talk about the deliberations that the student made and showing, you know, what turned out positively and what didn't and what they made a change. And it was just really cool, but it kind of did, yeah, I'm going to bring me back to this discussion right now. So nice job though. Very, very nice job with sharing that, you know, you've acquired a different perspective on UDL. I've been there and I'm glad you shared that. So Julie, in a classroom that was, you were sharing in a post, and the classroom had a larger population of students with emotional behavioral disabilities, that Chris, this teacher you had interviewed, and I know Chris wasn't the real name, you had indicated that, more often used station teaching. And I thought that was interesting because I was thinking with students with emotional and behavioral disabilities, that having that student off to learn without somebody being there or another student might, you know, just typically when you think of a student with emotional behavioral disability in a classroom and you try to visualize that, it's like, okay, that teacher or that student, and then there's like a teacher, there's an aide like nearby. And so I was kind of surprised by that. But happy, you know, that was happening and that was successful, that station teaching. So it meant that station was really engaging and that approach was really engaging for those students. So maybe it was, you know, very much hands-on. I can imagine a station, for example, that might have, you know, Legos or some Minecraft stuff or some 3D things that can be put together, whatever. It's like, yeah. But who knows? I you know, the books by Gary Paulsen, I remember a teacher who would have, in the Gary Paulsen books, if you look those up, they're mostly written for boys. They're probably, you know, ages 10 to, you know, 16, and you know, not written at a very high reading level, but very much focusing on like adventure and outdoors and things like that. And I remember a teacher, a special education teacher, and at the high school level, would allow students to read Gary Paulsen books in kind of a station setting. And these students just loved like every Gary Paulsen book, but they're again mostly geared in a genre toward young males, but they just were so into Gary Paulsen. So I'm like, whoa, that teacher Dean had really found something that was popular and engaging for a number of students. So. Coming back, you know, you mentioned most students with emotional behavioral disabilities. It almost sounds like students are kind of grouped in a classroom. So like more when classes are put together, that students with higher needs might be placed into one regular education classroom. I don't know if that happens. That happens for the purpose usually of scheduling for specials and kind of concentrating support. It also gets into tracking, so you gotta be careful with that. And it also gets into, okay, we have five excellent fourth grade teachers, and this one teacher though is great, quote unquote, you know, everybody, like with students with those types, quote unquote, those types of needs, so let's like have him or her, you know, let's assign these students to him or her. And what happens then is that just becomes a practice, and that teacher probably burns out. It completely isn't equitable. You know, all of the teachers should have, you know, you shouldn't have a high classroom, for example, academically, and a low classroom. Everything should kind of balance out. So had put that out there. Jessica, a quote from you: it would be challenging to learn new curriculum in looping. So of course, if you're at first grade and next year you're at second grade, so it's like, okay, I got to learn the second grade curriculum. Now you're third grade, I have to learn third grade curriculum, and then boom, got to come back to first grade. What's changed at first grade? So you really have to become almost this you know, curriculum, you know, guru, you know, this all-knowing, you know, curriculum person when you are in a looping situation. And yes, that definitely, you know, is the case. Now the strengths out of that are very evident, you know, because when you go back into looping, you know, like to a first grade level and you've taught second grade, you know at second grade what the curriculum is and what the expectations, so you can better match what you're doing in first grade to second grade. But you also brought up the question of, you know, you might have six sections of second grade this year, and then the following year you have fourth grade. So if you have this looping, what happens to you at the end of your looping? And do you loop back? Is there a position waiting for you? And then does it someone else get bumped? How does that all work? So it does get to be complicated. You really have to, as a district, think out looping if you do that. And definitely I could see where a person might not want to enter into a looping teaching arrangement if that meant, you know, you're going to put yourself, you know, kind of not really in jeopardy of a position, but, you know, if you really enjoy teaching, you know, second grade, you enter into looping, you know, you might end up at third grade or first grader. I mean, you might be moved around from year to year after your looping is up just, you know, because of where the numbers fall. So, and yeah, that's a really good point. And the amount of professional development that would have to go into making sure that you were current with the different curriculums, first grade, second grade, third grade, can also lead to exhaustion. I mean, so those are good points to bring up in looping. One of the things I remind people with looping, if you start it in a district, like pilot it, you know, and maybe just do it. It's 1 year to the second year, then you start over but pilot. Sometimes people feel they need to go in administration. They need to go all in some of these things. Like we have to just start completely off, you know, and everybody has to be running the race at the same time. And no, I mean, you pilot. And that's how you get a feel for how things, you know, work out and make adjustments. And then you kind of roll out on a larger scale if you decide that's what you're going to go with. So, Teresa, you referenced page 105 of the textbook, which indicated, and I'm quoting, traditional standardized norm reference test. On those tests, the performance of students with disabilities falls predictably below that of non-disabled peers. And that has always been a problem with using norm reference assessments. And, you know, because first, what is a norm, and also traditional standardized? Traditional standardized tests, I think another issue with traditional standardized tests is the vernacular of the test, the actual language of the test, isn't as accessible to students as it was in the past. Meaning, students who have learning disabilities, students with anxiety, students who are English language learners do not understand what's written on the actual narratives of the test. So they might have the knowledge, but they're unable to express the knowledge. That's where we come into universal design for learning guidelines. In balancing out these standardized tests with ways that students can provide multiple means of action and expression, you know, that they can show, and that means of representation that they can demonstrate what they know. Because yeah, I am not a big fan. Now, of course, you know, some of this is mandated by the state, so it's just the way that things are. But to truly understand where students are, you know, it's using your local, your grade level, you know, hopefully common assessments, and then embracing universal design for learning. So students do have the ability to demonstrate learning through, I had a high school student who demonstrated learning through rap music, not long ago. And this was about pretty complex governmental things in a government class. And the student is fairly skilled in this area of rap. I mean, has actually studied it, has emailed back and forth with rappers and you know, knows the cadence, knows the science to this. And this student will write out all of his raps, and then he goes back and will fact check his raps and so forth. And he's kind of become more political. And he's also appropriate. It's not like his stuff is, you know, calling for action against anyone or anything like that. It's more of an account of just his perception of politics in society, and Anyway, just to give you a little perspective first on the student also embraces strongly like the Martin Luther, you know, like you're judged by your character. So yeah. I mean, if we had a student who's doing, you know, raps about like threatening people and stuff like that, like, well, like, no, that wouldn't go. But this was the demonstration of learning. He's a great rapper. He would write the stuff out, do his narratives, analyze it, practice it, make sure that it connected together, that it was accurate, and then would actually develop constructs. Didn't know he was doing it until I kind of pointed out to him. I'm like, well, here you're kind of developing a theme of like this, and then here's like a theme of this, and here's a theme of this. And so he was actually doing constructs, but was telling these incredible stories, accounts of contemporary politics and history and influence through his raps. And the teacher was very impressed, and you know, he put his stuff on CD. I don't know if he's got it up on iTunes or not. He's working with a friend on that, but really, really some cool stuff. But part of that is the teacher said, "Yeah, you can do that. If you want to demonstrate that, go ahead. Just, you know, no profanity, and you know, no threatening, but." You want to do that? No one's ever done it. Go for it. And wow. Awesome. And this is a student, like if you were to have that student take a traditional test, has high test anxiety, is a student that probably doesn't, you know, wouldn't work very well in like graphic representations, you know, like drawings, things like that or whatever, charts, things like that. But in this mode, function indefinitely, the expression of knowledge was there. So, Maria, special education teachers would like push-in. You're talking about your school push-in services, but the caseload makes pull out the more practical model. And boy, that happens. That's very common. So what needs to happen for change, for more of a push-in model, one is, you know, teachers and administration just saying, this is what we want to do. And again, that pilot step of saying, well, we're going to aim, let's figure out what we do right now. Do we have any push-in services, any at all? Okay. If we do, where do we have it? How does it work? Can we increase it? Should we increase it? And that's your pilot. Okay. Of getting your baseline. And then some of this might include some schedule changes or, you know, like how people are assigned or if they're split between buildings and so forth. And, but again, you're acting in the best interest of a student. And I believe if you get down an effective push-in model, it doesn't take necessarily more time. The issue comes up if you have, teachers who teach students with emotional behavioral disabilities and those students then are not in the classroom very much, or something happens in the classroom and then they get taken out of the classroom to go to a special education classroom where they have fewer peers around and you know, might have a sensory break or whatever. Well, then that push-in model with the special education teacher isn't going to work because the teacher is going to be continually called out. So those are barriers, you know, that you've got to address. But I've seen push-in models work. So again, if you have people who are interested in doing it, have more discussion, and even if it's something that can be done for one additional hour a week in some capacity, and just taking it from there. So take those little steps. And I've done the gamut in my career, you know, from a little bit of co-teaching. I talked about my experience with Ruth, to virtually all pull-out services to now virtually all push-in services. So, Roseanne, you mentioned that previously in 4K, our students were allowed 30 minutes of technology time a week. Whoa, that's amazing. That's kind of like a 1980 number of, you know, getting to a little bit of a time with the Commodore 64, the VIC-20. It's really surprising that in this, you know, last couple of years that you'd have 30 minutes of technology, dedicated technology time at a 4K level. To me, it seems, you know, like it would definitely be more than that. And then, you know, you contrasted that. You talked about now you're setting, and it's a one-to-one iPad situation, and you have an interactive smart board. And those are cool because, you know, kids can get up with and move, drag things with their hands. There's so many, and there's different programs you can download for those two that are all out on the net, things that people have created. You know, it's easy. They're shared. You don't have to pay for them. You know, or you're talking about using Google Drive and even, you know, like where my daughter goes to school, the students have Google Drive accounts, and that's pretty common for districts that embrace, you know, Google Docs and Google Classroom. So yeah, she has Google Drive I have Google Drive. But as a teacher, you can share and then share things with other teachers. You can use that as a way for students to turn in materials, and you can have materials present for students. Oh, wow. Exciting. So I'm really happy that you have, you know, gone into this environment, which is significantly much more, embracing of technology than the environment you are in. So it's exciting. It's really exciting to read that. And I'm still going back to that 30 minutes of technology. Whoa. Trina, I actually have your Universal Design for Learning Guidelines document up on one of my side monitors. So you used a Google Doc to share your UDL videos. So awesome. Right there, you're using different presentation. You're using UDL to demonstrate UDL. I love it. It's great. And you know, so I have the one page poster, which is the magenta, blue, and green. And the number one is representation. Number two is action and expression. Number three, excuse me, is engagement. And you know, again, that one piece of paper, that one 8x11, and I mean, it's like, it doesn't even take up the whole page. And it cross references it to standards. I'm not sure which, I'd have to look at it a little bit more, but it, really easy to follow. And wow. Again, that's the one thing I would, you know, you can print off, reference. I talk about, again, your PDPs for licensure, your professional development plans. Now, I'm an old timer, so I have the 5-year licensing, which I have to renew my license before July 1st, so I should make a note of that. And so I do not have a PDP, but a number of you do have PDP plans, or if you're acquiring licenses, you know, obviously you're required to do the PDP. And then you have your specific learning objectives for your buildings and things like that. So incorporate these types of things, like that one-page worksheet saying, you know, like I will review this. I will cross-reference my lesson plans against this. And I will have, you know, a goal to make sure that actively, you know, I am having my students be able to represent, to have action expression, and to have, you know, engagement, to demonstrate the tenets of UDL throughout the quarter or throughout the semester. And I'll have that documented, like at least, you know, one activity, you know, per quarter or something like that. However you want to do that. But this is terrific to include in a PDP or in your own personal learning objectives. So just for anybody out there, please consider that. And it's really cool that you did that. And then you embedded the links, and then you clicked on the links, and it went right to everything. You did a nice job on that. Sometimes, not sometimes, kind of often, people will share things with me and in a Google Doc, and what happens then is it's not set to really share with me. It says, must ask for permission to, you know, have access to this document. So then I end up contacting the student saying, you need to give me permission to view the document. But yours was set up, came right up. It was great. Thank you. Stephanie, in your response to Maria. You mentioned that students learning together could compete against each other, you know, as opposed to working together toward a goal. So that kind of fine line of crossing into competition versus collaboration. And then also the question of, is competition bad? Well, we know competition isn't necessarily bad. You know, we have teams that compete, you know, academic teams that compete spelling, you know, people compete for spelling bee, athletic teams compete. So I think competition can also be, you know, be healthy, and competition is real world to understand competition. But when you have competition, you also need to have people understand their own baseline and their own growth from baseline. So if I am, so this is a wacky story. And when I was growing up, so I'm like 8, 9, 10 years old, my neighbors formed an Intellivision football league. So Intellivision, you know, was a very, very early gaming system, you know, prior to Sega and PlayStation and Wii and all of those things, years and years ago. And my neighbor, Richie, was great at this. And Mickey, I mean, and they, so I had just got my Intellivision and I was like a little bit younger. And I was competing, you know, against these other guys, kids. And I was, you know, I was losing, but I was having fun. But I remember, that, I once, Richie would beat me like 50-0 or something. And he was cool. I just wasn't very good. And for me, it was cool to play against him because like I knew this, he was really good. And if I could learn, and play better against him, then I could just kind of, that was my, you know, I'd be like, whoa, I scored a touchdown against Richie. Like, this is really cool. But, I had a game where I think I lost to him, you know, maybe like 40-30 or and something like that. And even though I lost, like I had scored 30 points against Richie and like nobody really did that. And I could tell I was getting better. So I felt good about that. So I was competing. And even though Richie had won the game, like I felt good because I demonstrated growth. So that's a more obscure example. But when we get into competition, it's important in inclusion in universal design for learning to help students understand their basal, where they're starting at, and to say, listen, competition's all right. And again, not that everything should be competition, because I do believe collaboration is warranted too. I'll talk about small group theory and how it relates to that in just a second, but to say, you know, you want to get better. And if someone else is really good at something, you know, learn from them and they're going to learn from you and something that you're really good at. So, but yeah, if you want to increase from your baseline. So we talk about how collaboration is important, and it is one of the biggest challenges. If there's a crisis situation is something called small group theory. And here's an example. So let's say that there is a virus outbreak in the United States. So this is something I studied in my doctoral research and actually something I did a podcast on in another presentation, pretty deep into this, and looked at a number of situations of small group theory. So small group theory would say that, you know, we talk about collaboration. We're going to get if we have a virus breakout. So let's say that's the scenario. Then the CDC is going to get together the top scientists in studying viruses and studying how viruses are spread. They're going to get together infrastructure folks on like how people travel. They're going to get together, you know, meteorologists who are going to understand the weather patterns and if it's airborne and things like that. They're going to get together logistics people understanding like how much, you know, if travel's interrupted, how much food is going to be at different, you know, communities and how long the food supplies would last and how distribute. So you have all these people kind of have to work together and they have to collaborate then to figure out what the response to this will be. And then also, you know, like military presence in there, like, you know, do we have to have a border, you know, that we create, which, you know, we can't have any travel over this border while we're trying to control this virus or whatever. So, but those small groups are very tricky to try to, first you have to have kind of an outside facilitator usually. And maybe, you know, too, when you talk about small groups of students, I think it's neat to have small groups where students like work together. It's also a whole other thing to have small groups and then have another person from another group assigned to help facilitate that small group. You know what I'm saying? So yeah, let's say you have small group A, three students, small group B, you have three students. And then at one point you take A and you have a student from A go over to B. And let's say they're working on totally different kind of things, but you know, A gets aware of what B's trying to do. B has to explain it a little bit. And then A facilitates, you know, some discussions of, okay, like, tell me more about this part of your, you know, you might have some script that you have to work, but then you're having people here have to talk about it and to explain of what's happening and why they're doing it, to this outside party, which is a demonstration of learning. It's again, UDL, it's a different demonstration of learning. I've seen that done a few times. That's really cool. So, Sarah, you put map scores in perspective by talking about the second grade student by the name of Sally and saying, you know, Sally's creativity isn't measured by a map score, and map scores do have limitations. So as with anything that is standardized, and map scores are a little bit different than standardized tests because the way map is set up, it does say that it does basal down to a student's, you know, the student's level where they have success, and then it works up from there. So, you know, if they're unable to answer correctly, well, you know what MAPS is, but you know, it'll work its way down and find, okay, here's where the student is successful, and then try to challenge them and figure out where that ceiling is. So, you know, yeah, MAP scores are valuable, but again, you know, it's one metric. And for universal design for learning, it's a piece of information, but it's not going to give you the information that, as I indicated, like the student who's able to give the rap song to talk about government politics and things like that. And you indicated Sally's creativity doesn't get captured in a map score. So use all of these things to inform, understand what's quantitative. So norm tests are quantitative. Map scores are quantitative. Understand what's also qualitative. Sally's, you know, creativity of maybe, you know, demonstrating through a picture or song or story or, you know, whatever is going to have a qualitative aspect to it. Having students work in small group and come up with some kind of solution, collaborate to some type of posed problems where then they need to incorporate things that they've learned into coming up with this. Either you can have it a convergent solution or a divergent solution to an issue. So, but, you know, like you could throw something out there really, really wild, you know, like saying, you know, if there were a meteor that was headed toward Earth, what would be things that, you know, we might be able to do to prevent that meteor from impacting Earth? So, and then also give more directions, like, you know, how would you get information? Who might you work with? Things like, here's your small group. And, you know, some students might say, you know, we could send up this, you know, spacecraft and it could land like something on it that would have like a big engine, like in, what's the movie? Like Despicable Me, like those big rocket engines, and that rocket engine could just, like, you know, activate, and then it would just kind of steer the course of this. Or we could aim this light up on it, and this light would, you know, also have an effect of, you know, changing the course of it, or, you know, different things like that. And, you know, then, you know, also, or if it was something like, you know, you wanted to create, a class garden or a school garden, how do we work together on getting people on board with that? Who would take care of it during the summer? You know, what would happen if who's going to weed it, and what would happen if we had a storm and it was damaged? Like, whose responsibility to go in and I mean, things like this. And then, so what would be, how do we have to get the resources? How do we judge, like, what grows here, what doesn't grow here? How do we harvest the stuff? How do we prepare? I mean, things like that. But that's collaboration. Division of labor. You teach those type of skills. So, great job, everybody. Thank you again for being very active in this class. And I do encourage you to watch the Fireside Chats. Not a lot of people have been commenting about the Fireside Chats. You don't have to, but again, that does count, you know, toward classroom post. In the past, more people probably have commented on the Fireside Chats, and I know, you know, there's people have spring breaks and things like that, but it is something where I do try to use this to really make a connection with what you're sharing in class. And hopefully, you know, you're finding this, you know, very valuable to look, you know, see this link, click on it and get this information, you know, versus, you know, trying to piece together, you know, different posts that I might be making and things like that too. And again, I'm a huge advocate of universal design for learning. And it excites me because the doors, if we really embrace it, the doors it opens for students are incredible. And for all of us, we can do a lot of really cool things, especially with technology on demonstrating our own learning. And I'll go back to Trina, you know, just saying, here's this Google Doc, and then boom, it links out. You know, I have it up on the screen right now, and it's just so smooth to do it that way. And I can take it, I can save it, I can share it. I mean, it becomes a live document now. And it's just so neat to see that versus you could have kind of reproduced this within your post and things like that and whatever, but wow, you know, so thank you. Have a great rest of the week. If the weather holds, I'm getting in a bike ride tomorrow. I'm aiming for about 40 miles. I usually do about 70, 80 miles on a bike truck. And I had a significant bike accident last fall where I damaged a lot of my bike components. I have a nicer bike. And I didn't even know if the bike was salvageable or not, but I did take it to the bike shop. It's actually Yellow Jersey Bike in Arlington. These guys are amazing. They've done this for like 30 years, and that's all they do is bikes. That's all they do. That's where you want to take your bike. And they determined the frame was still sound, and they're able to replace and actually upgrade some of the components for me. And I had the bike out with my 6-year-old who's been begging for a bike ride. I got her bike all tuned up, raised the seat a little bit because she's grown. And we took the bikes out, and I'm like, oh, my bike was really riding smooth, so I can't wait to get out and get in that first ride of the season. Although I'm going to have to dress warm. I don't like riding in cold weather, and I will not ride in windy weather if it's cold at all, because it's not worth it. But if it's cold, so we'll see, but I can't wait. It looks like it might be doable, and I have all of my stuff packed. A little bit of beef jerky, extra water, and Swedish fish. So if you're biking, if you're into biking, Swedish fish are very good to eat while you're bike riding, you know, for leveling out your metabolism. So can I cite that? Absolutely not. But I did find that in, I think, one of the biking magazines that I read through. So, and it did seem to work. Plus, they're good. Okay. Who doesn't like Swedish fish for that matter? But yes, have a good rest of the week. We are approaching 3 weeks left in class. So, you know what's ahead of you. You know your own spring breaks, your own calendars. And make sure that you do have everything completed by the 28th. or is it? No, by the 28th. Well, anyway, we have 3 weeks left of class. Well, I can find this out, right? Yeah, that's what I thought. So, April 28th, the class concludes. So, 17 days from today. Today's April 11th. So, April 28th, the class concludes. And then, are you ready for the summer? In about a month after that. So, thank you again. And I look forward to you continuing to be active posters. You're doing a great job. Any questions on grade book, let me know. I will make a post in the announcements thread every time I do like a formal update to the grade book. And, you know, I'll be entering things as we go along here. But a number of your grades should be in. But if there are a few things that aren't in yet and you see that dash, don't worry about it. So again and again and again. Yeah, please enjoy yourself. Enjoy getting outside, the warm weather if you haven't had spring break. Definitely take some time to yourself. And after that, what, with 7-8 weeks of school left? That's what we're at. So let's make it a strong finish. Thank you very much. All right, I'm searching for the stop tab. All right, here we go. Thank you very much.